Hey Potters, welcome to episode 41 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. Welcome to the madness that comes before life and the universe and everything.
I don't know where you're going with that, but okay.
Well, see, since 42 is kind of supposed to be the end of all things, this is kind of the penultimate end of all things.
Oh, Hitchhiker's Guide.
So we get to,
Okay.
Yes. Which means this is the episode that is full of madness and basically doing whatever the heck you want and before the end.
Sure, okay.
Never mind. My brain is just not here. My brain has been working since 9:30 this morning on homework.
My nose is still filled with like latex smell, so it's like I'm sure there's fumes in here that do not need to be moving around.
Speaking of being high, I can start with an update.
Sure.
Potters, if you watched last weekend, you may remember this. For those who are listening and not watching, I am holding up and unfortunately having to smell the fumes of the bracelet blank that I fiberglassed last time for those who watched the tutorial. And unfortunately, I pulled it out today. I accidentally left it out in my patio for a week, and it has a flaw. It has a very serious flaw that is not supposed to happen with fiberglass, and that is this. Looky, Ma, it's flexible, and it's not supposed to be. The whole point of fiberglassing something is to make it hard. It is not supposed to flex the way I am flexing the bracelet right now. So we know that one of a couple things could have happened with this, and as a learning experience, I will describe this to you. There's only two layers of fiberglass on here. So one of the things that I should have done is, one, more layers of fiberglass, probably at least three or four, if not five. And you also should harden both sides of your project, not just one, not just the outside. You don't necessarily have to fiberglass both sides, but you do want to make them rigid if you don't want your object to move, which in this case, I only fiberglass the outside. The inside is still foam, which I actually did on purpose because that's what's going to be next to my skin, and I really didn't want fiberglass next to my skin when I'm wearing this. The second thing that could have happened is that I didn't use enough hardener, which, being that I did not accurately measure what I was using, that is entirely possible. I'm not really known for always measuring my things. I'm pretty darn good at eyeballing, but sometimes I really probably should measure.
Carpenter's rule, measure twice, cut once.
Cut once. Sewing rule, measure three times. Cut twice. But at any rate, I probably did not use enough hardener. And the third factor is that I live in Texas. I live in North Texas, where it is always humid.
And this past week
has been exceptionally humid, by which I mean 100% humid. It's been raining for almost the last week here, which is glorious for the temperature and the weather, but terrible for fiberglass, because fiberglass really needs to dry in a dry atmosphere. Moisture actually inhibits the setting of fiberglass. So having 100% humidity for the last week probably did not help this set very well, if at all. In fact, it's still kind of, you know, tacky in a couple of places, which means it never actually fully set. So unfortunately, this bracelet blank, you know, is a dud. I'm going to have to throw it away because I can't use it. Granted, it's a little bit more thick than I really wanted it to be anyway. I actually glued together two pieces of 3mm foam. I probably should have used 2mm. I just didn't have any on hand. Which is something else I get to get at Joanne's today, incidentally. Today is Joanne's run day, where I get to go pick up materials for Barbicon. But I will probably be replenishing my foam stash. Because as a cosplayer, you can never have enough craft foam.
Yeah, you can never have tons of craft foam.
the stuff is the most versatile material in all of cosplaydom. You can use it for just about anything. It will take whatever abuse you throw at it. And I highly recommend having a giant stash of it because you never know when you will need it. So, unfortunately, you know, cosplay update. Also, incidentally, if you ever fiberglass cosplay accessories, It can take anywhere between 4 and 6 weeks for the smell to completely go away. So even though, you know, your stuff is set, it'll still smell like fiberglass. So I don't recommend, like, putting your nose up next to it, close, and sniffing, because you will get a giant whiff of fiberglass fumes, and it's really disgusting. So no, do not get high off your cosplay. Just saying. Do as I say, not as I do.
We probably do that enough just on paints and fabric dyeing alone. Man. We have so many chemicals running in our system. Sheesh.
This is why you should read the labels on your chemicals and make sure they're not cancer-causing.
But they're only cancer-causing in some states, like California.
I used to live in California. And I can't say the chemicals are really much safer there.
Well, like, okay, so since we're kind of moving into cosplay update section anyway, because today I spent money on some fabric and corset-making stuff, and one of the things I was buying was vinyl, and of course, some of the websites have this little, you know, prop whatever, 58 from California, saying, you know, this product may contain material that is hazardous to your health, blah, 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 blah. One of them was vinyl.
Yes.
Every single time I read that, I'm like, I've used it tons in the past. No worries, whatever. They're just being silly.
Just don't sniff it and don't consume it.
I was like, I'm not going to be eating it. I will be wearing it, and it'll be over layers of other fabrics. So it's like, it's not that big of a deal. It's just vinyl. Come on. What's the worst that'll happen? Nothing.
So what else you been working on besides vinyl and inhalation?
I've been working on lace. That's what I've been doing. I've been making lace and lots of it. I got to make 6 yards of it. Now, I know I don't think – did I say this in the last episode, how heavy the box was? Okay. So they did unintentionally send me more than what I had ordered. It was only supposed to be 6 yards worth, and it ended up being 60 yards worth. That's the weight of the really heavy box.
So they were off by a full factor of 10?
Yeah, and then some. They were really nice about it, though. They let me ship it back, and for the quote-unquote inconvenience, they let me keep up to 10 yards worth. So I have 10 yards worth of lace materials. I got 4 for free. Cool. So that's basically all I've been doing is working on lace. Oh my god, it's going to take me forever. I'll link a progress shot or something. I have one up on my Facebook, but yeah. It's going to take forever.
Just tell yourself, it'll look nice when it's done.
Yeah, I am really looking forward to it. I'm trying not to jump ahead and get it all done now, because it's something that's supposed to be for part of next year, too. And I still have 2 other projects to finish this year, even though I don't have anywhere to wear them to. Because con season's pretty much over for me. We still haven't heard back from A-Fest, by the way.
Okay. for those who don't know, we may or may not be going to Anime Fest at all. It's realistically, you know, weighted on whether or not we're going to cover it as press or not. Mm-hmm. So we're crossing our fingers and hoping that we can, you know, go and cover it as press so that we can film panels and gatherings and whatnot. But otherwise, based on previous experience, I think we're both more or less in the mindset that we would like to give them a year to basically get their affairs in order.
That's a PC way of saying it.
Yes.
I like your wording, ma'am.
We basically want to give them time to get their affairs in order and get the con running smoothly before we go back.
Right.
Basically, it's not because, you know, we think it's a crappy con. It's not. It's that if you go to a con and have a terrible experience, then you start to associate that terrible experience with that con overall. Mm-hmm. And, you know, A-Fest, for both of us, I think, has been, you know, one of our favorite cons, socially in particular.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
It's a fantastic con, and I don't want to sit there and think of it as a terrible con, you know, based on an experience. So I don't want to taint my memory of Anime Fest by going and having a terrible time.
Yeah. So the fun that I had at A-Fest last year really was when we were doing the press, when we were just being the press work. And that, for me, was the most fun that I had there. And that kind of sucked as an attendee and as a panelist, too, to get kind of shafted in the other areas. And I know that sounds mean and all that fun stuff, but, you know. Dude, it took me, what, 9, 10 months to finally get a medal for winning best in show, and it's a blank medal. Come on. Really?
Let me just say that it is incredibly difficult to attend a con as an attendee, a panelist, and as
And
press.
press.
It is incredibly difficult, not only in terms of scheduling, but in just trying to stay sane.
Somehow I did it.
Well,
I don't know how.
I'm not saying it can't be done, and whether or not we've come out sane is kind of questionable,
That's always
but
questionable.
it's just, sometimes you want to tear your hair out,
Yep.
whether it's your own or the one on your wig. Especially if you're cosplaying while doing all three.
Which we were.
Yes. Because we are a cosplay podcast, we cosplay even while we are press.
Which is why my April costume next year is going to be so awesome and comfy to wear. Woohoo! I'm so looking forward to that one. I'm a
Com
nerd, shut up.
comfort, comfort is definitely a big factor in cosplay, especially if you're going to be running around as panelist or press. Comfy shoes, especially.
Oh God, yes. Shoes make a difference.
Incidentally, I pinned two whole pieces of my Erza cosplay I've been trying to work on.
Woohoo! You've accomplished something.
I feel so bad. I want to work on it so badly, but one, homework comes first, and we just finished the two longest chapters in the entire class over the last 2 weeks. They're really long chapters. So I've had, a lot of catch up to do on homework. In fact, I've still got, I think, half that chapter left to finish making notes in my journal for, my engineering journal, that I get to use on the skills final, which is why I have to spend so much time on it.
Yay.
It will let me pass my skills test. But aside from that, I've been trying to sit down and make neck wraps. Neck wraps are the little, tubes of fabric, tube of fabric basically,
She
that
showed
you,
this once before.
yeah, you stuff it with little polymer beads, and I'm trying to sell them to make a little money on the side so that, one, I can kind of reimburse myself for Barbican, and two, because, cosplay sewing ramp-up season is coming,
Oh, yeah.
if it hasn't started already for a lot of people. So cosplay supplies require money. And since I have a $500 tuition payment due in a week, I could use a little spare fundage for cosplay supplies. No, I'm not going to ask the listeners for that. I'm taking care of it myself. So I'm going to try and sell neck wraps, especially since, my fellow coworkers are in an exercise program like I am and can probably use them. In fact, I have two of them myself that I use for motorcycling
There you go.
because it keeps me cool while I'm on my bike when it's not pouring rain outside.
In the nice, hot, humid Texas weather.
Oh, it
Yay.
wasn't hot anymore by that point. It was just humid.
Well, it was a little hot yesterday.
I was really glad that after I rode through the nice shower that I rode through, that I was not sopping wet because I had to run
Yeah.
into Walmart. And I didn't really want to track water all the way down the aisle.
I think that would be the least of Walmart's concerns.
Probably, especially since I was giving them money. But as a safety hazard, I appreciate not tripping up other people. I'm trying to be considerate.
That's very considerate of you, because most people at Walmart do not care.
Well, most drivers aren't considerate of me on my motorcycle anyway, so I may as
This is
well,
Texas.
give a little back. So, due to my class schedule, I'm thinking that next week is our last lecture this coming week.
Oh, okay.
It will be this past week by the time we release this episode, but it's our last chapter in the class, and hopefully that will free up time for me to start working on cosplay in between studying sessions for my final
Right,
exams.
right.
So then I'll actually have some time because I would like to be able to finish at least redoing one costume for Anime Fest. That would be nice. Mostly because I've already torn up part of the old one, so I can't wear it anymore. Yeah, that was a mistake.
Rethinking now. Wait,
Well, it's not going to
uh-oh.
matter. I was really unhappy with how I applied bias tape to my top. So the very first thing I did was I ripped off the bias
My
tape,
tape.
thinking I was going to redo it, just the bias tape part, and I was like, I may as well just redo the whole top because I was really unhappy with the fit. Mm-hmm. Which, speaking of which, pro tip, if you work with a pattern, even a commercial one, that has your proportions on it and it matches you, that does not mean it's going to fit you correctly.
No, it won't.
And I was using, in fact, since you asked me about this earlier, and I could talk a little about it,
yeah,
I used a Mrs. pattern for a kimono top. The actual pattern itself, the physical pattern I was using was for a dickie, which is basically an undershirt, but I modified it slightly, and the pattern was too small for me because I was a dork and did not read the pattern sizing on the back of the envelope correctly. It was, you know, teen sizing, not adult sizing. So while, yes, I do fit into a lot of Mrs. clothing, Mrs. patterns, you really have to read them to make sure that they're, you know, adult Mrs. and not teen Mrs. And so I had to size up from that pattern a lot. It probably would have been the equivalent of 3 sizes. I had to size up. And I did so successfully, you know, it's the right size. I can breathe in it. You know, it's not clingy. But the fit is all wrong. It does not flatter me at all. It has darts. You know, women traditionally have front darts. They're bust darts, basically, in the front. Those completely fell in the wrong place, given where my bust actually is. And so basically, I ended up having to pin the piece in place using magnets. I couldn't use actual safety pins because they would have shown on the outside of the costume. You would have seen these little, you know, silver rods everywhere. So I used magnets in strategic places to hold it so that it kind of semi-fit.
Ooh, magnets. Oh my goodness.
They're very, very strong magnets. That fabric will not move when you put magnets on them. It will not move. So, you know, the magnets weren't visible, which is all I cared about. It just has to look good for the photos. And then you basically take it off at the end.
It has to look good.
Well, I mean, when you wear cosplay, you just try and cover up the flaws as best you can, and you go. Because, you know, the photos are going to be eternal. You're going to take the costume off at the end of the day. So you just want the photo to look good, because the photo is the one that's going to last forever.
Yeah, we call it the 10-foot rule. If you're 10 feet away and it looks awesome, then you did a good job.
Exactly.
Doesn't matter what the rest of it looks like.
Exactly. So it's always easier to, one, size down from a pattern than it is to size up, because the proportions don't always carry as well. And two, you really need to pin fit the pattern, which I did not do because it was a last minute, hey, can you, you know, be part of our group? Or, hey, we need this character for a group. Can anybody do this? And it was 4 days before, you know, basically the con started. So I whipped that baby out in 4 days with final exams at the same time. Did not fit any of it to myself. I just sewed it and went. Worst thing I have done in a long time. Not ever, just in a long time. Did not fit me well at all. But you know what? I went and did it anyway. So check the fit on your costumes.
Probably a good idea, yeah. This came about because I was in the process of getting all my corset stuff, and they had this little kit that basically, here's all the basics that go with this pattern, and it was the pattern that I was going to use anyway. So it's just kind of like, okay, may as well get it all together, save some money, no problem. And here's the thing, I make all my own patterns. I don't buy patterns because I suck at reading the patterns. I suck at sizing the patterns. I'm just not good with patterns. Unless I make them myself, because I know what works on me and what doesn't work on me. Commercial patterns suck on me. So with this corset pattern, I was like, okay, so I'm like a 12 in the top, but I'm a 10 in the center, but I'm a 14 at the hip. Amber, which way is easier? Is it easier for me to size up, or is it easier for me to size down?
Whereas
I don't know.
I'm used to buying commercial patterns just because...
Yeah, she's the opposite of me.
Yeah, I'm actually the other way around because I actually have 38, 30, 40, or I'm sorry, it's 36, 36, 30, 38. I have like the exact proportions as, I think it's a size 14 on the envelope. So I match everything. So I can just buy a commercial pattern and generally just go, but I have to move darts around. I have to move seams around. So I'm kind of lucky in that sense, plus I'm lazy. Commercial patterns, basically they have a group of professional seamstresses draw up these patterns and do everything for you. And I generally don't have any problems, you know, reading their instructions as long as they have a picture next to it, because I'm a visual learner. So I'm all about commercial patterns, as long as, you know, I can move stuff around, because I'm special.
I have special. I don't fit any commercial pattern.
I have special proportions. But it's okay. It doesn't bother me.
Yeah, and if it wasn't for the fact that this is a corset, I've done one without any boning in it, so it was meant to be like an underbust, it was meant to be just something loose so I could tighten everything together. I'm doing something nice and pretty and professional. I kind of want to get the pattern so I know that I'm doing it right. I'm using all the stuff that we learned from that corset class, so. Coming in handy.
Yep.
Looking good so far.
Whereas I will be picking up a cheerleader uniform pattern today at Joanne's for Sailor Pluto.
Yay, happy dance. Have you decided what fabric you're going to be doing for her skirt?
Traditionally, most cosplayers do it in satin.
They use the Casa back satin because it looks nicer.
I am considering going for Casa. I may use a crepe back satin.
Yes, that one works too.
Because I've worked with that one before, and at least that one, since it has the crepe backing, my sewing machine has something to grip. So,
if you want,
you know, I'm all for that.
If you want a fun alternative, the one that I use with mine, I use sateen. So I did cotton sateen with mine.
You know, I'm open for other options. This is not something I'm going to be able to work on, you know, very soon. I don't know how my homework load's going to be in the fall, because basically I have my final exams, and then class ends on August 15th, and then on the 22nd I start class again.
Mm-hmm.
So I have 1 week off, and then Anime Ooh. Fest is the week after that.
Right.
And then I have classes until, you know, December.
Right.
And then I may stop. We'll see.
We'll see what happens from there.
Well, it's going to depend on, you know, what's my job situation like?
Right.
And, you know, am I, you know, do I still have enough money to keep paying for this since I'm paying for school out of pocket?
Right.
You know, that sort of thing. Because I would like to be able to work on cosplay on a higher level, you know, to actually have the time to sit down, pay attention to my seams, do everything correctly so that it looks professional.
Be crazy and make lace like me. Man, I still need to find a handler for that one too. My original handler has backed out on me, so I need to find a new handler.
But at any rate, I believe you have a tutorial for us.
Yeah, we have tutorial time. I did this earlier today just for you people. It's how to apply latex prosthetics to your face, in particular it's a bald cap. So, enjoy!
Hey guys, Val here. So, after I posted this request in our last episode recording, a couple people wanted me to do this, so I'm going to be doing a bald cap tutorial on how to apply it, the adhesive to use, how to make the seam for the ball cap fade away on your skin, as well as how to remove it properly. So I'm using a bald cap simply because that's what I have readily available, but this tutorial works as well for any type of latex pieces that you'll be adhering to your face. So things like scars, full masks, nose, earpieces, you name it. Just happens to be the ball cap is the easiest way to go, and the one that I'm using, I'm getting ready to toss anyway, so whatever happens to it today, doesn't matter. A couple of things first. Let's first start off with what you're going to need. So of course you're going to need your bald cap, and this is one that I've had for a while. This was actually a backup for a costume that I made. And as you can see here, it's kind of, you know, no longer useful. So, but you're going to need your bald cap. Bald cap you can get at any party store. You can actually pick this up at Party City. I know some people are going to say, well, that quality is not as good. Honestly, as long as you're slow and you're meticulous, the Party City bald cap works perfectly fine. But if you're not so certain about that and you want to get a higher quality piece, you can go online. Amazon.com sells a variety of them. Monstermaker.com is also a really good website. It has a lot of different types of latex bald caps available. If you are allergic to latex, there is silicone-based bald caps, and that you will have to get online. Monstermaker.com is probably one of the better websites to get alternative types to latexes. Make sure that you get the one that's labeled latex, not rubber, because the rubber is not going to do squat for you. It's going to look like crap. Simple as that. Next thing you're going to need is spirit gum and the remover for it. Also something you can get at Party City. You don't have to get the fancy brand. Because I do a lot of mask and latex work, I went with the higher quality. Ben Nye is something you can get online, or if you have a local costume shop, more than likely they'll have these available. The other thing you want to get is liquid latex. Also, can be found at Party City. This particular brand is not something that you can get at most costume stores. You actually have to special order this online. Unless you have a high-end costume shop like Nor Costco, which tailors more towards theater costuming. But there you go, liquid latex. Usually you don't need this much, but because, again, I do so much of it, I needed a giant bottle. You are also going to need your brushes and, or in this case, sponges. So this top one is the wedge, which is most commonly used. Makes for even lines when you're applying your liquid latex, or you can go with the bristly one. The bristly one is great for when you want to do like scars and scabs. It kind of makes your skin prick out and looks more unnatural. It's good for zombies. You're also going to need a barrier spray when you're done applying everything. This ensures that everything kind of stays in place, less likely to melt or fade throughout the day. If you're on the cheap or if you need something really, really quick, hairspray works. The other things that you are going to need are a wig cap. Now, I don't personally use a wig cap unless for some reason I need to put my hair up all the way because I have such a nice high forehead. Genetics worked for me on that one, so I don't really need to use it when I'm working on my bald caps, but most of you will need to get a wig cap for this. And that should be about it for the materials. The other thing that I recommend that you bring is paper towels, because spirit gum gets really, really sticky. So it's just good to have these, because your hands are probably going to get sticky by the end of the day. Okay, so the first thing for prep work is how to put up your hair. And I'm going to try to do this so that people can see it. If you have short hair, or if you're a man and your hair is probably longer than your chin, what you'll want to do is use hairspray and hair gel. Slick it all back as much as possible. Put on your wig cap, stuff up any of that hair into the back of the wig cap, and then you're done. It's really that simple, it's not that complicated. The biggest thing is just making sure you get most of the hair fibers, or pretty much all that you can, away and out of your face. And if you have sideburns, that's where the wig cap comes in handy. Now, if you have medium hair, which is what I have, which is probably about shoulder length, this is what you're going to want to do. But I'll try to do this without looking too weird. You're going to want to pull your hair back into a low ponytail, so you don't want it to sit too high up, probably right about here at the nape of your neck. And then you want to do a braid. It's really that simple. Hairspray to death. You don't want any weird, random stray hairs coming out of your braid. Now, if you are needing to put your hair up completely, like you don't want any of your hair showing, this is where the wig cap will come in handy. You're going to want to pull your hair up like this. Pin it down with a ton of bobby pins, and I mean a ton, and then put the wig cap on. Now, this is good for situations where you need to actually hide all of your hair. You don't have a way of hiding it in your costume, or you have nothing covering your neck. And this is the same procedure that I used to do when I actually had longer hair. By longer, I mean longer than my shoulders, like down to here. You're basically going to be doing like a Princess Leia, Empire Strikes Back bun thing. Now, the costumes that I have done so far where I've needed to wear a bald cap, I've actually been able to hide it in my suit. Particularly with my Asajj Ventress one. Then there's a neck piece that she has which basically covers everything, so you don't have to worry about putting it up, and it actually makes the cap look a lot more flush against your skin. In those type of situations, what you'll want to do is the same type of technique. Low ponytail, braid it, and then when you're putting on your ball cap with the rest of your costume, try as much as possible to squish your hand down over your hair. I know that sounds ridiculous and it looks stupid, but when it all comes together, it makes sense. So there's my little thing about the hair stuff, because no one really talks about how to deal with your hair, especially if you have longer hair. Okay, so now that we've done that, we're just actually going to dive into it, and I'm going to put on the cap itself. I am not going to do a full makeup demonstration on this because, one, it takes a ridiculous amount of time. Two, this is such a crappy cap right now that it would be kind of moot. So when you initially take your wig, the bald cap out of the package, it's more than likely going to be stuck together. Latex tends to have a tendency to stick to itself, which is kind of a butt. So when you first open the package, be really careful and delicate with pulling it apart. Now, latex does stretch to an extent, but you don't want to like overstretch it, because then you're going to get rips and tears like this lovely piece right here. A great way to keep the latex from sticking to itself is to use baby powder or cornstarch. I recommend baby powder because, one, it smells nicer, two, it's a lot easier to wash off in case you get some of it on your head. All right, now the fun part of actually putting this thing on. This is how I do it. If you have a friend to help you, it is so much easier. But this is the back of the cap. This is the huge neck flap that goes in the back that'll cover your excess hair. I try to do it like this. And yes, see? So much. This is why I'm not doing the whole thing. Actually, I don't know if I can tear this off. There we go. Hey, hey, no more cap at the end of the day. Yeah, that comes from many years of wearing. I've had this cap for about 2 years now as my backup, so I know it's not in the condition to be worn again out in public or with my costume. Basically, this is what you're going to end up doing, is you're going to be pulling at this sucker as gingerly as you can to get it as flush with your face as possible. And you don't really want any wrinkles up here on top because no one really has. Okay, people have wrinkly heads. It just comes with the territory. But when you're a fantasy character, you probably don't have a lot of wrinkles up here. So try to keep it as flush as possible to your head. Now, when you initially get your wig cap, it's actually going to have a piece right here. So this entire section is going to be covered with latex. What you'll want to do is the first time you ever put it on is just take a Sharpie and mark out where your ear is. Take off the cap and then cut out the marker area. It's really that simple. You don't have to do anything too crazy or too ostentatious. But as you can see, after time and you start pulling at it and working at it, it's going to become flush to my face. Works for you? Cool. Now the next fun part, which is using the spirit gum. Almost all the spirit gums that you're going to find on the market will have a little applicator that comes with it. If you want to use something different, you can. You don't have to go for anything too crazy or fancy. So this is how I do's it, or does it, depending on what vernacular you want to go with today. All right, so I roll my cap up and I apply the adhesive to the cap. We're going to go all the way down to the side. And then I'm going to show you guys a trick on why this works. Okay, and then we're going to roll it down. This is the part where your hands are going to get in the way and everything's going to get sticky and oh my god. Alright, so hold it, press it, and then we're going to roll it back up. There's a reason why you do that. Spirit gum activates in air. It gets stickier and it gets tackier once it's in the air. So when you pull it back down again, it will maintain its hold so much better. And this is the part where I should probably remind everybody you should have a clean face before you do this because it just makes the adhesive stick a little bit better. And then you just press it down and hold it in place. Now I didn't do it all the way back here, which is why that flap is still kind of like As you can see, it really is just that simple. And I usually let it sit for about a couple of minutes while I'm working on other parts of the cap. But mostly the parts you're going to be doing is going to be right here along the front, behind the ear, and this is where having all that hairspray come in handy. So that way you don't have to worry about this stuff getting stuck in your hair. And then if you're needing to hide your hair back here, that's why this neck piece in the back is so excessively large, because, oh look, it can cover my hair. Now there are people who will use a different product called Prosade. Prosade is a medical adhesive. It's not something that you're likely to find at a costume shop, but it's a type of adhesive that will stick on through just about everything. You can sweat in it, you can run outside in the rain with it, it's not going to come off. The downside is that because it's not so easy to take off, you actually have to get the adhesive to remove it. If you try ripping it off your skin, it hurts and you're going to have welts there for days, if not weeks. So when you're actually using it and taking it off, please use the remover for the love. It hurts like a mofo if you don't. Okay. Next step. You're going with the liquid latex. Now, liquid latex smells like nobody's business. It smells horribly, in fact. Most of these will come with an applicator, some of them do not. The brush applicator I'm okay with. I actually prefer to use the sponge because it's a little bit more consistent. And it's really, really simple. You just dip your sponge in, try to get the excess off. And basically what you're doing, and I'm going to try to do this so the camera can see it a little bit better, is you're going to be applying it right along the edge and up into the cap. To get a nice even line. And this is to make that weird little edge along the cap disappear. And it's probably going to take you a couple of layers to do it. And you're basically going to sit and let it dry and do another layer on top of that, do another layer on top of that, and so on and so forth. If you are allergic to the latex and you're using silicone-based stuff, an alternative is to use Prosade, or I've heard people do this too, and I'm surprised that it works, is to use like Elmer's glue stick, because it washes off really easily, and it will easily come off your skin. It's not going to stick to anything, and it's not going to irritate your skin. Elmer's glue is school glue, so it's not going to do anything too terrible to you. And Prosade, again, is a medical adhesive. It doesn't have any type of latex product in it. So you do something similar to this. You clump it together to kind of hide the seam. It's really that simple. This is the fun part. You sit and you wait and you watch it dry. Yeah, this is why I tell people to always test their makeup before they go out and do it, because they may not realize that, oh, you know, I'm just putting paint on my face. That's only going to take like 30 minutes. No. For my Darth Simmy costume, because I've done it so many times, I've been able to get it down to 1:30 for the makeup. And it's actually, that's pretty good, because I know a couple of people where it takes them 4 hours plus to put their makeup on. My Asajj Ventress, I can get it done in about 1.5 hours, 2 hours, because that's full white face makeup, and that's actually a lot harder to cover your face with. If you use darker colors, it's a lot easier to cover your face versus the lighter colors. Okay, next round. And then as you can see, it's just basically building up layer over layer over layer over layer. It's going to feel weird at first, but once it all dries, it looks awesome. So you guys can see that a little bit better. Hopefully you can. if it's going into my eyebrow. This stuff is great. I mean, it's non-toxic. I can pull this off my eyebrow a little bit and it's not going to take any hair with it, so it's cool. I'm not concerned. I have done way worse with makeup and spirit gum. How are you guys doing? Doing good? Yeah. This is the boring part. I'm sorry. There's not much to do than just to sit and wait. And this is exactly why I am not doing full face makeup for this demo, because it would just take forever. And ever and ever and ever. And I don't think my camera batteries would not survive. Anything interesting to talk about. This is why you also want to get a friend to help you, because man, even just to have somebody to talk to, that's what kills me. When you're doing this all by yourself, it gets so boring. And they can help you for any mistakes that you may possibly make. But since we're sitting here and we're doing the waiting game anyway, why don't I talk about the makeup that you can use? You don't have to use face paint stuff. I would recommend it though if you're doing like a standard flesh tone bald look. It just looks so much, it's just easier to apply, easier to make it all go together. For any of us women out there know this. The foundations that are out on the market are never going to match your true shade. I know I have a pain of a time trying to find anything lighter than light because I'm very fair skinned. In fact, this is actually incredibly tanned for me. I'm much whiter than this. So, the cool thing about the face paints is that they have such a wide variety on the market. Now, Ben Nye is one, Mehron is one, you can get, shoot. Da! There are also alcohol-based ones that you can use as well, that come in a variety of colors. They're easy to mix together, but they also have a huge series of flesh tone colors. And it ranges everything from the lightest of light skin possible to the darkest dark skin possible, and everything in between. So I would probably recommend using those not only to color the rest of your cap, but to ensure that you get an even blend with your skin when you finally do the makeup portion of it. And as you can kind of see here, the line is fading. I know you can still see the line, but once you start applying the makeup to it, it's gonna be non-existent. Like if you were to touch my head right now, it feels flush. Like it feels like it's all part of my normal skin. And then I do one more coat just for safety. And then I'm gonna take this off my finger. There we go. Yeah, even just as I'm doing this on my head, I can feel it. I can feel I can't even, no. Let me reword that. Doing this on my face, I can no longer feel that seam between the cap and my face. So we're gonna squish off any of this excess. And you can dispose this normally. This doesn't need to be like a chemical biohazard thing. You can just stick it in the garbage and you're done. That's really all there is to it. Once that dries up, it's really, really simple. It's just time consuming. And then, of course, when it dries, I know I'm speeding up the process because, the tutorial. Hold this away a couple of inches from your face and spray. That's it. Do its thing, open up your eyes, and you're done. It's that simple. Another technique as far as blending the latex and your face and all the colors together is to use eyeshadow. I haven't tried this yet, but I saw this online. I thought that's such a cool idea because there are a ton of different colors of eyeshadow on the market now. And you don't have to spend, an hour trying to mix your face paints together. It's really great for those of us who are doing like different skin colors like blue, green, orange, purple skin. Because blending a lot of those paints together can be really tedious. Just trying to find that right exact shade sucks butt. So that's A cool thing about eyeshadows, because there's so many different colors, you're probably going to find that right shade right off the bat. And it just easily brushes into your skin. No problems, no need to worry. And you don't have to worry about messing up any previous face paint you've got on. So I'm going to be trying that the next time I do Ventress, because man, trying to get the white to all mesh together sucks. All right. I'm going to touch this. Ah, see? So good. It's so fat and flush. And it's dry too. It doesn't take long to dry at all. All right, so now the fun part, taking it off. With spirit gum, you can rip it off. It kind of hurts a little bit, and you might get a little bit of a red spot there for a day. But when it comes to this latex part, you don't need to do a whole lot to it. Paper towel, wet it, and slowly start rubbing away. Because as you can see, it's starting to crinkle. I'm going to try to lift myself up here. It's starting to crinkle here. And then you can also pick at it and see, starting to roll off. Can you see it? It's really that simple. It's really easy to get off. And this is just the latex part of it. This isn't the rest of it. Really simple. And now when it comes to the spirit gum itself, you can do this with your fingers. You should probably do it with a brush. It's a little bit better. But basically what you're gonna do is you're gonna get a peel up a little corner. I am so right-handed. And then slowly wiggle your way down. And then the cap will start to come off. And then you do the same technique with the prosé too. And you just keep working your way down. There we go. We're almost there. It's the last little bit to go. There you go. That's simple. My head can breathe again. And then I always do this just for good measure to make sure I get off any excess spirit gum that might still be on my face. Because as you can see, even with, you're gonna get a little bit of a red mark. It's not gonna be terrible. It usually goes away pretty quickly. And then so you don't smell like the spirit gum remover. Just run a damp cloth over your face. But that's it. That's all you have to do. There's no magic trick to this, and it's just a matter of taking your time, not overkilling it, and just practice. Practice, practice, practice. Don't do this the day before of a convention or the day of a convention, because you're going to find yourself frantically trying to make this all work. Give yourself a couple of weeks. Do a couple test runs at home, get a feel for it. And that's all I've got. If you've got any questions, just make sure to bug us on our Facebook page, because I'll be more than happy to talk about anything with latex adhesives. See you guys.
And we're back. You guys totally missed the commercial I just did for Plastic Beads Wholesale. Speaking of which, you
Follow up.
know, well, they don't sponsor the show.
No one sponsors the show.
Nor would I, you know, take them up on sponsorship. But, you know, as a cosplayer, if I find a place that I've really enjoyed doing business with, I will say something, because it can be really difficult to find places that are good to do business with. And I don't mean like, okay, you know, I purchased my thing, I send them money, they send it back, and you're done. If they have, you know, particularly good, say, customer service, or if they have particularly good selection or return policies, then I will say something, because that's, you know, hard to find these days. I happen to like Plastic Beads Wholesale simply because everything in anime has gems now, and casting good quality gems takes practice.
And the butt.
It is a butt. So if you know that you're going to do several costumes, that happen to have the same color gems, then, you know, at least plastic beads has them in bulk. So I can at least have them all look the same, because they are all the same, instead of having to worry about resin casting where they may have little imperfections. They may not look the same. So I just happen to like having things that all look identical for a good price. I mean, yeah, you have a $30 minimum order, but to be quite honest, it's really easy to reach the $30.
I mean, especially
given the quantity you get.
Yeah, when you start doing a lot of the more expert beading work, or you're doing like the ball gowns, it's like that $30 is nothing. You're probably going to spend $80 to $100 just on getting all the right beads that you need.
And shipping is free.
Yeah, can't go wrong with that.
Yeah, I have never had any problems with them. I do wish they carried larger than 35 millimeter rounds, which round bead, round kabocha. I do wish they sold larger than that, up to 2 inches is what I was hoping for, which is 50 millimeter. But sadly, all they carry up to is 35, which is a little bit more. It's a little less than 1.5 inches. It's a little more than 1 inch. So they're literally about that big.
Maybe like 1.25?
Ish. Like 1 1/3.
Okay. That's a good
fractions. Fractions are hard.
Fractions are evil.
It's 2/5. It's 1 2/5 of an inch.
There you go. We'll just go with that.
So yes, I really like plastic beads wholesale. Speaking of other things I have found cosplay related, not necessarily businesses, but I stumbled upon a group called Southern Cospitality today on Facebook.
I've known them for a while, but I've liked them for a while.
For those who don't know, they are basically a group that is there to show off cosplay. It's kind of a perpetual cosplay of the day showcase sort of thing. So, you know, if you want inspiration or you just want to see great cosplay, I would say definitely give them a visit. They're called Southern Cospitality. C-O-S, Cospitality. Ha ha, ha ha.
Ha ha ha.
Also, there is a Facebook group called Cosplay Panels Online that we have been a strong contributor to. And basically, it is a repository of videos of cosplay panels that have taken place at conventions around the world at any time. So if you want tutorials, you want to know how to do something, or you just want to watch entertaining panels by your favorite cosplayers, they have a... Yes, we featured on some of them, as we are also panelists. If you want to go over and have a look, they are on Facebook under Cosplay Panels Online. I highly recommend going to have a look.
If you're not sick of us already.
Yes, we are a large contributor of theirs simply because we do a lot of filming of cosplay panels. Which isn't a bad thing. I mean,
we
film them.
We do it for you.
Yeah, we film them so that people who can't go can see them still, which that kind of peeves me a little about Comic-Con.
Yeah.
I know that, yes, industry people show premieres of things and they don't want everybody being able to see them, that it's just for attendees. At the same time, they're capping attendance at 130,000 people, which means not everybody could go even if they wanted to. It's very expensive to go. And not everybody can even get into the panels they want to get into. Even if you were to wait for 4 hours in line, you still may not even get into some of those panels.
Four hours is generous.
So frankly, you know, it would be nice for those who want to go but can't, literally cannot go, can see those panels. I would love to see some of those panels, even if I'm not a comic book fan, because they do other stuff besides comics there. So
they have really good gaming panels.
They have excellent gaming panels. They have TV show panels. In fact, I just looked at the write-up of the new Avatar The Last Airbender, Legend of Korra. Season 2 is coming out in September. And they debuted the first episode at Comic-Con. Now, while I'm okay, yes, it's not supposed to debut until September, and that was a premiere for attendees, I'm cool with that. If they want to leave that to attendees, that's fine. But to be able to see the rest of the panel, I want to see that. Mm-hmm. I want to be able to see what content is in the panel, even if I can't watch what's shown up on screen. So that does kind of peeve me about Comic-Con, that they don't necessarily allow videography. Or photography in some of them. Some of them, they don't allow any recording.
Oh, yeah. Some of them are just like, no, not happening. Yeah. Well, people still sneak things in. So you know how that goes.
I know, but then again, that also kind of ruins it a little bit for the rest of us. Because then they go, okay, you guys violated the rules. Now we're not going to have the panel at all.
All. Ever again.
I am never coming back to this con.
Oh, good gravy.
And I know we are about to do cost confessions, so I'm looking for the post I made.
Oh,
because I did several. And for those who aren't on Facebook, they didn't have a chance to see them.
I say, while you're looking for that, I actually had one that I wanted to throw at you. And this could kind of be a cosplay confession, but is there any costume that you can think of that you would love to create, but you don't think you'll ever achieve?
In terms of capability of creating it, or in terms of wearing it to look good?
Capability, maybe it's just self-confidence, maybe it feels like you'll never actually live up to the character standards.
So it's more of a, I don't think I could get the character across?
Something like that.
To be honest, I actually have a lot of problems with Lena.
Oh, really?
Yeah. One, completely different body shape. Mm. Two, completely different personality. She is an extrovert and I am a major introvert.
And you know what's funny is everyone that I know who's ever cosplayed Lena has been an introvert.
Is an introvert. And to be honest, I don't look like a girl. By which I mean like small, young person.
Woman.
Right. I am a mature woman. So basically I feel like I'm dressing up like her, but I'm not getting the character across. And while it's a nice costume, and it is, it's just character isn't getting across. It's a performance thing.
Okay. I could see that.
Oh, and Naga. I have been asked to do Naga 3 times.
I have to, yeah.
And physically, yes, I can pull it off. Personality-wise, no. Goodness, no.
She's something. That's a tricky one.
I can clear the room with her laugh. But she's even more of an extrovert than Lena.
Yeah.
And she also flaunts herself, which I'm really not. No. Just no.
No.
I'm not a fan of...
No.
I'm not a fan of wearing skimpy clothing either. Mm-hmm. And she takes skimpiness pretty much as far as it can go to be legal at a con.
Yeah.
So, no thank you. I don't know. I always kind of have, you know, issues about pulling characters off in general.
Yeah. Well, it's hard because there's certain things. I mean, a lot of the times, even the stuff that I wear, I don't think of myself as actually portraying the character until I'm, like, on stage for a contest or if I'm in front of a camera. When the camera's down, I'm just my normal self. I'm just like, I'm playing dress up. I'm not actually going to be the character. I'm not going to be running around as Amelia. I'm not going to be running around as whatever villain I am today, you know? It just seems awkward to me to fully go into the character until I'm in, like, stage mode, or I'm in camera mode. At least that's how I see it.
Actually, that kind of goes right into the first confession I wrote up on here.
Oh, well, there you go.
Which is that I don't like wearing my own costumes. And that may seem surprising as somebody who has so many of them, mm-hmm. And I really enjoy making them. I really enjoy making costumes. But it's more that I enjoy the engineering of the costume than I enjoy performing in the costume. Because I know that I suck at stage presence. So I really, really enjoy it up to the point of finishing the costume. And then, I enjoy wearing the costume as a costume. But I'm not really good at making the character come across because I'm such an introvert. Mm-hmm. I do enjoy having pictures taken of my costume, but that's more because it's my costume and not because it's me in it. So if somebody else were wearing my costume, great. Love it. That's perfectly fine with me. I would be just as happy.
That makes sense.
If only I hadn't, and then I wrote, if only I had more time for commissions.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to do next year, 'cause I like making costumes, and I just want to scale back not only for myself so I can do more of the elaborate stuff that I'm trying to do next year, but so I can take on more commissions and do more fun things that are outside of my normal realm. Make other people happy.
Have you noticed that costumes are getting more and more elaborate?
Ridiculously so. That's why I've been trying to up it up for next year. That's why I'm doing so few.
I
Oh
mean,
my
the
God.
upper level, what most people might consider the upper levels of cosplay are getting ridiculously elaborate. Not only in the detail, but in the materials that they're using, for the amount of time that it takes them to do these, and the entire range of techniques they're having to use. Because basically, I mean, some of these people have actually taken cosplay up to, say, movie replica levels, which in a way is kind of disgusting. And I don't say that in a bad way. I don't say that in a bad way. I say it in that for those who are just entering the art, it seems like the end goal or the peak is moving farther and farther away. And while, beginners have a lot more access today than they did to tutorials and things like that enable them to make these ridiculously elaborate costumes, I feel like the art is just kind of diverging itself to where the highs are getting higher and it's getting harder for the beginners to get up there.
It's intimidating. That's really what it comes down to. It is intimidating as hell. You
Heck
see some of
yeah.
those things and you're like, there is no way. I'm just starting out. I'm gonna just go buy my Sailor Scout outfit because that's gonna be way easier than trying to make it myself.
And cheap cosplays are plentiful and abundant.
Yeah.
You can buy a sailor outfit for $50 now.
Yeah. May not be 100% accurate, may not look as great, may not fit you properly, but hey, you got a costume.
Yeah, and
Run around with your friends all day, so.
it will be close enough that people can definitely tell who you are.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's a plethora of, I guess, what you might call basic entry-level costumes, prefabricated entry-level costumes. And, those who are in the upper echelons of cosplay spend literally hundreds of dollars on materials alone, let alone the loving labor of months and months worth of work,
Oh, my
which
wallet's
in and of itself can
crying.
be intimidating. If you know in advance you're going to have to spend $400 on a costume just to buy the materials, let alone the labor, I'd be intimidated too.
Don't remind me. I'm gonna start crying.
Well, here, this one will segue nicely with your bald cap tutorial.
Sweet, cool.
I suck at stuffing my hair under a wig. My hair is shorter than it used to be, but even with the length that it's at, I still have problems hiding my hair, and it's not because I have problems hiding my hair, in the back. It's
It's up
that I
here.
have problems hiding my hairline and my sideburns. So that unless I have, usually I end up taking a wig and I part it right over my ears so that I have strands to cover my sideburns since I refuse to bleach them or dye them. And I just have to pin the heck out of my wig to get it to stay in front and cover my hairline because otherwise the weight just pulls it backward
Back.
over my head and it starts exposing my hairline, which for those who are listening and haven't watched the video or seen me, my hair is almost jet black. So it's really obvious when my hair starts showing. And I have tried pin curls, I have tried, French braids, and I just suck at stuffing my hair under wigs.
Yeah,
That's the beginning and end of it.
I say for the cap tutorial that I did, I gave a couple suggestions on how to hide your hair because that's one thing I've noticed online. Most people don't talk about how to put your hair up or how to hide it or how to make it all work in this area. So I'm hoping that my tips kind of sort of help. But yeah, I will admit that I'm very fortunate in the fact that I was born with a naturally high hairline. So the falling back thing is a very rare, rare thing. When it does happen, I know when it happens, and I can easily, quickly fix it. So, there's just no easy way. It's just one of the things you have to pin the living crap out of it and hope for the best.
And get a really good quality wig cap.
Yeah, the wig cap helps a lot.
There, for those who do not know or have not used wig caps, there are basically two major types of wig caps. There's the nylon kind, the net kind that basically looks like pantyhose, which a lot of people use pantyhose. You can. There's absolutely nothing wrong with buying a 30-cent pair of pantyhose at Walmart and turning it into a wig cap.
Cut off the tail,
Especially
stick on
since,
your head, done.
Tie off the top. There you go. And they're going to wear out. All wig caps wear out
Oh, they
after
all do.
time. Just from sheer use, they will wear out. So, 30-cent stockings may be an excellent option, especially if you end up using them as like maybe one or two off wigs. The other kind is a net kind, where they're woven kind of like a volleyball net out of stronger fibers. And they're better for pinning into because there are open spaces. You don't have to worry about tearing the wig cap open to get holes for your pins to fit through. I just looked like I was shooting myself. No. Pins going into head.
Pin go
Yes.
into head.
Pin going into scalp.
Pin go slidey, not like chuja jab jab.
Yes. So, I have one of each for my wig caps. But I heavily prefer the netted kind just because I have to pin the living daylights out of it.
That's what I do too.
You not only have to pin the wig to your head, but you have to pin the wig cap to your head
Head.
to make sure the wig cap doesn't slide back and take the wig with it, which will happen. Would
Invest
and
in a very large pack of bobby pins.
Exactly. I was about to literally say that I have a bag of barrettes and pins I take with me to cons. I have alligator clips, and I have a stronger equivalent of bobby pins that go
There you
with
go.
me. I think I have.
I have a special bag just for it.
I think I'm up to 20 or 26 of them that I have to use for my hair. And that doesn't even count the barrettes I have to bring separately for just pinning my hair itself up.
Self up, yep.
Not even the wig cap or the wig, just like my regular hair. Because you have to pin that up too, incidentally. So, 10,000 pins later, you'll have a wig cap that theoretically doesn't move along with your wig. That was so awful when I wore my UA wig. I kept having to tug it forward the first time because I didn't pin the wig itself into my wig cap.
Oh, whoops.
And the weight of it, because it is effectively two wigs, the weight of it kept yanking it backward on my head. So finally, I had to pin the living daylights out of that wig. And it still tried to slide back because it was so heavy. But, that's the nature of wigs.
It
Your
is what
turn.
it is. Yeah, I can't think of one. Probably because I'm tired and my energy's starting to away. My energy is going down.
Confession on my part, I prefer pants over dresses and skirts.
I think we talked about that one before. Whereas I'm the opposite because I hate making pants. I love wearing them. I can't make them. Amelia is like the first pair of pants that I've made that I was really proud of. And I still think they're crap.
Although, frankly, skirts and dresses make it easier to use the restroom, which is a consideration you have to have when you're at a convention in cosplay.
I make a lot of dresses, which is funny because I don't wear skirts ever. Ever. I also have a thing for redheads, and I don't know if maybe that's just my inner ginger coming out. Because I am a very pasty white lady. Who happens to be part Irish and burns in the sun very easily. I'm a
That
daywalker.
works.
I'm a daywalker, I know it.
Although it seems like a good portion of my cosplay for next year involves dresses or skirts of some kind.
Yeah, I have a lot of dresses, very long dresses too. I'm trying to think. April will probably be the only comfy one because that's a big yellow jumpsuit.
In fact, I need to persuade you with cookies to help me make a duct tape dummy.
Oh, okay, that's easy. I don't mind. I like helping out with that one. I got lots of duct tape.
And cookies.
You
Well, I
want
mean,
the blue or the aqua?
doesn't really matter. It doesn't even have to be duct tape. I mean, if you want to use packing tape, that's cool too.
Well, I got a ton of packing tape too.
But if I want to do Cosmos, then I'm going to have to do body formed pieces so that they actually like look like they're fitted to my body. Because I don't want to do applique for that. It doesn't look right.
Right.
It's not 3D enough. It's flat. The ones I've seen, beautiful cosplays. It just doesn't quite look right.
Right.
So I'm going to end up taking what I think is going to be 2mm foam and heat shaping it exactly to my body and then fiberglassing or macheing it so it's hard and then strapping it down like armor, basically.
That could work.
At least that's how it goes in my head. I still have to figure out how that's going to work because if I have a hard strip down my front, I can't bend over. Which is why chainmail would have been the better option, but quite frankly, 15 pounds of chainmail around my neck does not thrill me.
That doesn't sound very appealing. I think we'll pass on that.
Yeah. especially if it's helm's weave, which is twice as dense as normal. We'll see. I'm still thinking about it. I may end up having to do the applique anyway, just for comfort and for movement, ability of movement. There you go. There's a confession for you. I don't always consider ability of movement and comfort in my cosplays before I finish them. I don't always think about the fact that I have to be able to go to the bathroom in this cosplay. UA. And I don't always think about the fact that I have to be able to bend over. And I don't really consider the fact that I'm going to have to be able to, you know, move my arms and raise them above my head, Umi. Or any other sort of freedom of movement issues.
Which is, I'm the exact opposite. I intentionally pattern and make sure that I got everything cut in such a way so I know I can move and walk around and be comfortable and use the bathroom. I pre-plan all that stuff before I even start anything. But
speaking of
I'm logical.
I'm actually going to have to take off the skirt from Deedlet. I'm going to literally have to cut my cocktail dress in half so that it is a shirt and skirt combined together. I'm going to have to redo the skirt.
Wow.
Because
I
made it based off of a pattern that fit me all too well, and I do not have freedom of movement. The dress clings to me, and if I have static, tries to ride up my legs.
Ah, okay.
So, quite frankly, I need to have more ease in the skirt, which I did not design enough of, clearly. And the only way to get a skirt on that is to, you know, basically cut it off at the waist and then put a skirt back on. Because, I mean, she wears a belt, so I'll have the seam covered. I just have to place it very carefully. And I'm going to hate doing it, because I am not very accurate at keeping things equal on the front and the back sides to make sure I cut it at the same place for the skirt.
Yeah.
I'm not very good at that.
You'll be fine. I have faith in you.
I better be. I'm going to take a tape measure, and I'm going to measure up from the bottom of the skirt X number of inches, and I'm going to go around to the back and measure up X number of inches.
Inches, just to be sure, yeah.
Just to be sure I am exactly right. Because I can't even make markings on it.
No, you won't be able to.
I mean, I could possibly make markings on the inside of it, but I'd have to use pencil because it'd bleed through the front. And it's like, oh, great. And if I screw up with my cutting, there is no going back. I'd have to redo the whole thing, including the hand embroidery on the chest, which was a pain in the rear end. Oh, my God. That was worse. No, it wasn't worse than applique. Applique was worse. But the hand embroidery was pretty darn bad. It really was bad.
All the things I like to do, Amber doesn't do. All the things that I hate to do, Amber likes to do. Maybe we need to make a cosplay team between the two of us, and then we can finally be awesome.
By our powers combined.
Yeah.
We are Team Cosplay.
We will rule all the contests.
Oh, God. I'm not sure I want to do this. Especially given our experiences at cosplay contests as of late. So not sure I want to be doing that.
I've enjoyed my year off, I must say. It's been a lot more relaxing and fun.
See, if we do the if we do Anime Fest, I'm still considering entering the cosplay contest.
Oh man, and I don't know if there's a cutoff limit this time. I have no clue. I haven't looked at any of that at all. Ooh, they're
Because
thunder.
I considered taking UA since I still wasn't able to win anything at Project Acon. It's
I
like,
think
man,
you have, might have a better chance because of their craftsmanship there.
kaboom! Yeah, which I'm going to be bringing UA anyway because I think it's Mary is going to be wearing Sakura.
Oh, okay.
And she's like, you know, I'm bringing this to Anime Fest if you want to bring UA for a photo shoot. I was like,
Oh,
okay.
cool.
So I would have him there anyway,
Yeah.
which is one of the things that I wanted to get done for A-Fest, is to remake the shoes into what they're supposed to be instead of the lame last minute kind of weird thing I hot glued together that I ended up with. Plus, at some point, I need to actually tack the wings down correctly instead of the way they are now. Because they won't open fully without ripples. And I don't like the ripples. I want it to
Poor
be able to
thing.
fully extend without the ripples, and I know it's because I glued them in an awkward place. So, we'll see. I'm not redoing those. I am not redoing those. Ah! Oh my god, no.
You'll be fine. I have faith in you.
Although, at some point, I may consider putting real feathers on it. Gluing real feathers down.
Why not some
Because
craft
that.
foam feathers?
Huh?
Craft foam feathers. I've seen a lot of good tutorials that look like real feathers, but they're all craft foam.
I've seen them. In fact, some people use felt.
Yeah, they've done felt too.
But in this case, felt would probably not work as I'm looking at it. Felt wouldn't work as well. Plus, effectively, anything that I glue down on top of it's going to add weight.
Well, of
And
course.
frankly, they're already 5 to 7 pounds with the harness, which is why I considered real feathers, just because those won't really add any weight.
It'll add some, but it'll be so minute that it won't make a
It'll
difference.
be insignificant. Although, given my workout lately, I should be able to carry it. And then some. But anyways,
I
we're
think we're
off.
well past an hour here, and plus my tutorial is like 20 minutes long. We might want to go in the after session before people
Yep.
start tuning us out.
Yep.
What was
So,
that 30-minute time limit that we set up a year ago?
yeah, about that.
About that.
At
Whoops.
any rate, we will see you listeners in the after session and have a good cosplay weekend. Enjoy
Bye.
Comic-Con, those who are there.
You suck.
Not how you want to end an episode. You don't want to tell people they suck.
The people at Comic-Con suck. I'm sorry. I want to be there. I'm jealous. Bye, guys.